Today's topic is the nanomaterial applications. This is the second last part of our syllabus where we'll talk about the applications in the various part of this subject PS452. We talk about the introduction, then we talk about the crystalline materials, then the quantum mechanics involved in the nanomaterial synthesis and their characterization. Then we talk about the different characterization techniques, including the synthesis technique like the sol gel, chemical deposition, ball milling, and number of other methods. Then we talk about the various techniques to characterize the nano-sized materials or nanoparticles. We started with the scanning probe microscopy and then transmission electron microscopy along with the different type of AFMs. Like in last class we talked about the EFM, FM, and scanning thermal microscopy and so many more. Now we talk about some of the applications or the core applications of the nanomaterials in the various fields. The major classification of nanomaterial applications is in three parts. The first one is for the electronics, second one is for mechanical engineering, and then we talk about the generalized application of nanomaterials like in defense, in aerospace, in fuel, and maybe in medical also. So I start with the introduction of the application in electronics. As we know, the electronics is having different phases. Like before 1947, we talk about the vacuum diode tubes or vacuum tubes. But the science of the material changes after 1947, where Brayton and Shockley devised the solid state electronics. Before 1947, whatever we look for, the solid state devices are based on the vacuum diodes. And they are basically bulky, power hungry, expensive vacuum tubes, which slowly can be replaced with the tiny, less power consuming lightweight devices. But this is in 1947 where the solid state physics is inventing the new material and new techniques to develop the solid electronic devices. This made portable space saving and compact equipment possible, but this is the initial stage where we look for the improvement in the electronic devices. It was realized as early as 1958 that in one tube form, shrinking not only the size but also the fabrication is possible on the integrated chips or the integrated circuits on the silicon chip. And this is again a reversal thing about the electronics that 1958 onwards, the most of the electronic circuits are fabricated on the integrated on the silicon chips. Extrapolation of this idea and development in device fabricating technique like lithography not only made it possible to fabricate very large scale integration of electronic devices. So by using the technique of ICs, integrated circuit technique, we capable to fabricate the large scale devices on this same chip. Now when we talk about the applications in electronics, we need to understand that how the technology adopted by the electronic engineering or electronic people to understand the fabrication as well the realization the size of the transistor which may be fabricated on a particular chip. Like Moore's law in around 1959 just would have predicted that there would be reduction in the size of electronics with time, and this is quite a surprising one that he predicted in 1959, and his theory is well applicable till 2000. After 2000, there are some deviation in the Moore's law. So according to Moore, in every 18 months, the reduction in the size doubled. It means every 18 months, suppose I'll say the 100 transistors are fabricated on a chip of 1 centimeter square. Then after 18 months, the number increases to 200 and the size of the chip remains same. Or the 100 transistors may be fabricated on the half of the size of the 18 months old. So this is what he assumed, and it is one of the best results in electronic engineering that after every 18 months the fabrication count is doubled on a particular chip. Or the other one which is more important is the processing power of computer level. So there are two or three ways to talk about the Moore's law. The first one, 18 months, the reduction in the size is doubled, or the number of transistors on a chip is double, or the processing power of computer is double. However, following this law, the device is now lower size of approximately 100 nanometer. Nowadays, in 2010 onwards, we are looking for the devices which are in the size of 100 nanometer. And remember, the fabrication of this small size on the material on the chip is simply violating the Moore's law. This is the curve which is showing for the upload of CPU transistor count against rate of introduction. This is the year and this is the number of counts. And if you look on this one scale, after every 18 months, there is almost double the count of the transistors on a particular chip. It can be noticed that since its direction, it was a linear graph, but after 2000, means till 2000, Moore's law is 100% adopted and it is absolutely fine. But after 2000, as we are reaching for the smaller size, maybe in the size of a few micron or in the nano range, there is some deviation from Moore's law. The electronic devices with typical dimension of pure nanometric, either of three directions displayed, maybe in the XY plane or in Z plane. Not just miniaturization, but unique property not known before last 5-6 decades since the beginning of solid state devices. Like 1947, we talk about the reduction in the size due to the solid state devices which are invented, and in 1958 approximately, where we looked on the fabrication of the electronic devices on chip. But as we move towards the nano size, or as we move towards the nano fabrication of these devices, the world is completely changed as we are looking on the properties, because the efficiency is increased, the size is reduced, the power consumption is very much decreased. So these are the things which we look in each and every instrument. Few examples of the electronic devices. There are a number of applications of the nanotechnology or nanomaterials in the electronics, but we'll just talk about a few of them which are quite new as well, quite important for us also. The first one is a single electron transistor. Here we will talk about the quantum dot concept. It is simply even a single electron which passes through a quantum dot behaves as a transistor whose efficiency is approximately 100 times or 1000 times better than the transistor which we are using nowadays. Spin balls, magnetic transjunctions are conceptually new devices based on the nanotechnology. Spin ball is based on the spintronics. Spintronics is something which is related to spin of the charge and electronics. Magnetic tunnel junction is also based on the same, the concept of the spin. These devices are faster, compact, relatively cheaper, and finding their way to market. This last one is very important and are finding their way to the market. Still, we don't have these devices in market, but may possible we'll get it in 5 or 10 years. And when we talk about the procurement of these devices in market after 5 or 10 years, there is change in the speed of each and everything. Now the first one is the spin wall. What are the spin walls? It is simply based on the spintronics. Spintronics is the combination of spin with the electronics. So a spin wall used in the personal computer to read disk, which are enabled to increase data storage capacity of hard disk. If you remember earlier when we talked about a computer, used in personal computer readings which have enabled to increase data storage capacity of the hard disk. The spin wall and magnetic tunnel junctions are based on the concept which itself is going into an area in itself known as spintronics, or spin plus electronics and magneto-electronics. This is new branches of the electronics where we look for the properties based on the spin and based on the magnetic property of the spin. The spintronics, it is well understood that an electron has one charge and spin. Our electron is so far is only the charge property of electron, and spin has been negated. So before we look on the spintronics, we every time we talk for electronics of the electron or holes, means the motion of electron and hole is important for the electronics. But nowadays we are looking for the properties based on the spin of the electron. And by looking on the spin, it's very easy to look for the new properties. And remember, the properties which are based on the spin are superior to the property based on the charge. And it's very easy to control the spin-based properties which may not be destroyed by the just scattering of or collision with the other elements or other charges. So it is taken into account properly fabricated devices would lead to some superior devices using an external field. Spin transfer can be controlled. Advantage with the spin is that it cannot be easily destroyed by scattering from collision with the other charges, impurities or defects. Now spin products. There are a number of devices which are already present in market, but remember these are not used in commercially. These are still in the laboratories. Like spin FET, spin LED, spin RTD, RTD stands for the resonant tunneling diode. optical switches with the terahertz frequency. Generally we talk about the devices which have a frequency of in gigahertz, but these devices which are based on speed are having capacity to run at the terahertz frequencies. Modulator, encoder, decoder or qubit for quantum computer are on the hot list of the scientists and technologists. These are the devices which are based on the spintronics. Then we have the non-volatile memory devices which are used for the computers, that even a sudden failure in the electricity or any other property of the computer, but still our memory or the data is never lost by using this type of memory, which are known as non-volatile memory. And the last one is the quantum computer. That is one of the most important term used by the engineers and scientists, that they are looking for the quantum computers whose speed is very fast, and they generally use qubit as the term instead of using the digital signal 0 and 1. The last one is the flip panel televisions, computer monitors, coding used on the screen. used on the screen or TV monitor, TV or monitors. Better properties in terms of color quality and resolution than microparticle coating. This is all about the properties of the or the applications of nanomaterial in the field of electronics. Now, next one is the applications in the field of energy. We generally look for the energy means the natural resources like oil, coal, natural gas, but these are exhausting and maybe after some time it is completely exhausted. So we look for the some more applicative part or some more fuels or some more sources of energy. One of them is the solar energy. So how can we improve the efficiency of solar cells using nanotechnology, that we'll discuss over here. Generally, all the devices, all the type of natural resources are producing energy, and that energy is utilized for the transportation, communication, agriculture, industry, houses are limited and depleting very fast. So what are the future resources of energy? One of them is the solar energy, and second one, which is very important one, hydrogen based fuel. But till now the hydrogen based fuel have some drawbacks, or say the cost of storage of hydrogen based fuel is still very high. So we may find some factors which may decrease the cost, and within 5-10 years we'll get the hydrogen as a fuel for the our vehicles, everyone at the households. Now what we are looking for? Applications in energy. Efficient solar cells, like using nanomaterial, can increase the efficiency of the solar cell. Then splitting of water to get hydrogen fuel. Remember, as I said, the hydrogen fuel is one of the neat and clean fuel where the chances of pollution is very low. So if by any means we split the water and store the fuel in the form of hydrogen, then it is the best part of the nanotechnology. Photocatalysts, these are the used to split the water in presence of some nanomaterials, and the photocatalysts which are used are basically nanomaterials. Available hydrogen can indeed become a good source of fuel for automobiles and other transportation purposes. As I said, if we got the storage problem solved for the hydrogen, then it is best fuel used for the transportation and all energy requirements. However, storing hydrogen is difficult. It may get spoiled because hydrogen is stored at very high pressure. As it come down or come out of any container, immediately it oxidizes and burns. So this is the biggest trouble with the hydrogen, that it catches fire and it is very dangerous. Carbon nanotube, these are the potential candidate to store the hydrogen, but still the work is going on to store the hydrogen in the carbon nanotubes. Carbon nanotubes have application in the battery technology. This is another one, that how can we improve the fuel cell property. So in general we talk about the lithium ion based batteries. Lithium ion batteries are available in the market for each and every field. Even if you talk about the 5 volt, 10 volt or say 4 car batteries, everywhere we require the battery, and those batteries are based on the lithium ion batteries. But nowadays, by replacing the lithium ion with the carbon nanotube, it is possible to increase the efficiency of the fuel cell. So lithium charge carriers in the sum of the batteries can store inside the nanotube. One lithium atom can be stored for every 6 carbon of the tube, and in result it is easy to store the lithium ions. Storing hydrogen in nanotube can be possible application for the development of fuel cell for fuel cell automobiles. So exactly in same way as we store the lithium ion in every 6 carbon atom, same way may be used for the hydrogen storage in the carbon nanotubes. A fuel cell consists of two electrodes separated by a special electrolyte that allows hydrogen ions but not electrons to pass through it. This is the diagram where we can understand that the hydrogen is sent to anode and where it is ionized. The free electrons travel through an external circuit wire to the cathode. It is moving through outside and in result hydrogen ion diffuse through the electrolyte to cathode where electrons, hydrogen and oxygen combine to form water. The system needs source of hydrogen. So whenever we have a source of hydrogen, it is possible to ionize the hydrogen and use as a fuel. Some other things, all the electronic gadgets require rechargeable lightweight batteries or cells. So if we have the nanomaterials, we have the carbon nanotube in their cells or batteries, then it is possible to increase the efficiency or long lasting batteries which may be used for each and every electronic device like computer, mobile, smartphones and everywhere. The present batteries need to recharge frequently or replace due to low energy density or storage capacity, but by the application of carbon nanotube it is possible to increase the efficiency and storage capacity also. The energy density could be increased using the electrode material, metal hydride, nanoparticle like nickel hydride or high surface area lightweight aerosols are used to increase the efficiency of the batteries or to replace the conventional lithium ion batteries with the nickel hydride or aerosols to improve the efficiency. One more application in the field of mechanical, like earlier we are changing the efficiency of batteries through the use of carbon nanotube. Here also we talk about the betterment of the materials by just using some of the nanoparticle in a non-polymer. So here I just talk about one of the polymer, polyacrylonitrile is a well-known technology to increase the strength of plastic composites. So here if we use some carbon fibers in polyacrylonitrile, then it can increase the strength of the material. So use of long carbon fibers such as polyacrylonitrile is a well-known technology to increase the strength of plastic composites. Pen has a tensile strength in the order of 7 gigapascal and can have diameter of 1 to 10 micrometers. So its length is 1 to 10 micrometer, but the strength is very high, which is approximately 7 gigapascal. The use of such fiber for reinforcements require further develop to have fiber preferentially oriented and uniformly dispersed in the material, because it's very tough to deposit or to spread the nanomaterials throughout the body. So it is required a particular direction, particular orientation to be followed in the the procurement of the carbon fibers in a polymer, so that their properties can enhance. How effective fiber is in increasing strength of composite? Tensile strength of fiber, length to diameter and length to diameter ratio, these are the properties which is increased by the procurement or by the adding this fiber to the polyacrylonitrile PN. Because of high tensile strength and last length to the diameter to ratio, carbon nanotubes are excellent material for composite reinforcements. Remember, in earlier classes I talked about the carbon nanotube and their efficiency or especially mechanical strength is much better than the all other non-elements, and even if it is comparable to the diamond and buckyball. The use of such fiber for reinforcements require method developed to have fiber preferentially oriented and uniformly dispersed in the material. Fiber must survive in processing conditions. So these are the things which are important while the synthesis of the material. If we take care of the synthesis of the material, the fiber are properly procured inside the non-polymers, then it's very easy to improve or enhance the properties of the material. Work at General Motor Research and Development Center has shown that adding to polypropylene 11.5% by weight of nested carbon nanotube. This is the experimental result which are obtained at the General Motors. Nested carbon nanotube having 0.2 micrometer diameter, approximately double the tensile strength of polypropylene. So only 11.5% amount of carbon nanotube in polypropylene increase the strength by twice. So it is very useful even in the automobile industry, that by using carbon nanotubes we can increase the tensile strength of the material which is used in the cars, like generally steel or iron or these are the material which is used in the car body, but those materials may be replaced by the lightweight carbon nanotubes. Next one is the applications in automobile. So whenever we talk about the application in automobile, the first thing which comes to my mind is how the nanotechnology is useful for the car, because it is the most important part of everybody's life. So simple car, when we talk about the simple car, the various parts of car, it contains large number of parts and materials like steel, some alloys, rubber, plastic and all those. They are heavy in size, they are having high density materials. Body structure should be strong, non-deformable or rigid of desirable shape and size. So by use of nanotechnology, or what we require is the body structure should be strong, non-deformable or rigid of desirable shape and size. Like nowadays what car companies are doing, they want to increase the mileage of cars, so they replace this steel and all those by the polymers, which is not very strong, and even at a small hit and the body structure of car may be damaged. So by using this carbon nanotube, it is possible to increase the strength of the material, and if we increase the strength of material, then it is easy to use in the car as well. The weight of car is reduced. Nanotube composites have mechanical strength better than even steel. As I said, the nanotube, carbon nanotube composites are having much better properties than steel and all other non-metals. Attempts are being made to make composite that can replace steel. Still, the research is going on and may be possible in the next few years. We may find that the steel is completely replaced by the carbon nanotubes. Applications in automobile. In continuation, we talk about some of the other things. Like as I said in last slide, nanotube composite have mechanical strength better than even steel. But as I said, still the research is going on. And what are the drawbacks? The synthesis of nanotube is not economically viable, but attempts are being made so that it can be used on large scale. Still, the nanotechnology is in under process of research. When we got the final results, it may possible that we got the some industries where all the products of nanotubes may be manufactured, and those are applicable for daily life. Cars are the other one. The first one is in terms of the strength of the material and body part. Second one, which is very interesting one and a very important one. Some sprays are possible to use which may change their color by just applying some voltage. This is a quite beautiful thing about the nanotechnology. That cars are spray painted with the fine particles, nanoparticles paint, provide smooth, thin, attractive coating. Even some research is going on to explore the possibility of applying a small voltage to change the color of the car as desired. This is the important one. Next one is also an important one. It is possible to use special window glass material, self-cleaning glass. This is made by the titanium oxide, where it is not required to clean the glass. It is easy to clean by the same material, which is titanium oxide, and it is mixed with the synthesis of the glass only. So not necessary to wash the windows with water. The self-cleaning glass made by dissolving small amount of titanium, which is titanium oxide TiO2 nanoparticle in it, while manufacturing it by melting together its ingredients. Means while the preparation of the glass which is made for the car are we dissolve the titanium or titanium oxide which clean itself as the light or maybe some voltage is applied to the material. Titanium is able to dissociate organic dust in presence of ultraviolet light available in sunlight. So this is the way how it clean the glass. Once dissociated, it may be fall down or simply evaporated. Even drops of water on the glass gives hazy look, but titanium oxide containing glass can spread water evenly, giving clear sight. So it is very easy to clean the glass or say clean the car, because we are not having any effort, we are not giving any effort to clean the glass. Only the titanium oxide based nanoparticles are dissolved by the synthesis of the glass material. The another one application in automobiles, the very powerful motor using shared memory alloys. These are the different type of alloys which are developed based on the nickel titanium or some other type of alloys made in the nanostructure, maybe by ball milling or some other techniques. These models perform better and are less power hungry than other motors. So by using shared memory alloys, it's possible to increase the efficiency, the performance and increase in the size as well less power consuming motors. Nanoparticle clay, this is the type of material which may be used in the rubber so that it makes it thinner as well, less consumption of the rubber while movement of the vehicles. Use of nanoparticle that catalyst convert harmful emission into less harmful emission from engines. Whatever type of engine we are using, it reducing the gases which pollute the environment. But by use of nanoparticle catalyst, it is possible to make them less harmful what they have nowadays. And the last one is the large surface area of nanoparticle is useful to produce better catalyst. And remember, the one of the most important application of catalyst in the industry of the polymers. That we will discuss in next class. Next one is the application in last one, sorry. The pollution product then is resolved by use of hydrogen fuel, where hydrogen fuel is burnt, it can produce only harmless water vapor and that may be evaporated in the environment. Next one is the hydrogen fuel. When we talk about hydrogen fuel, we need to understand what are the drawbacks of the hydrogen fuel and how can it is procured in the market. So the problem with the hydrogen is storage. Compressed hydrogen is very dangerous, low energy density, so it immediately absorb the fire or it immediately catch the fire. Liquefied hydrogen is very expensive and cooling and compression result in loss of 30% of stored energy. So maybe liquefied hydrogen just for the transportation and it is very costly as well. It is loses its 30% of stored energy while with lowering down the temperature and the compression. Metal hydrates deliver hydrogen simply at a constant pressure which is sensitive to the impurities, so only up to 7% of its weight. So it is possible to use the metal hydrates to store the energy in the form of like sodium hydride or calcium hydride, maybe CaS2 can be used to store the hydrogen, but again it is very expensive as well. It is very sensitive towards the impurities. Then the other option is liquid carrier storage uses fossil fuels as source of hydrogen, defeats purpose of using alternative energy. So these are the drawback or these are the problems with the storage of the hydrogen fuel. Now how to store or what are the other options of storage of the hydrogen? Chemical compounds are utilized as hydrogen storage units. Technique include ammonia cracking, partial oxidation, methanol cracking, etc. These are the techniques which may be used to store the hydrogen. Eliminate the need for storage unit for the hydrogen produced. So by using these techniques, by making ammonia cracking or partial oxidation, it is possible, but again it is very dangerous. So what are the alternatives to store hydrogen? Because as I said, the application of hydrogen is much better than whatever fuel we are using, like coal, natural gases and petroleum products. Store hydrogen in the pore of microscopic tube and within tube structure. So if you have the carbon nanotube, then it store the hydrogen atom or hydrogen fuel inside it or within the pore which are present inside the carbon nanotube. Similar storage mechanism as heterohydrate and visible is used, but the efficiency is much better. Just look over here. They are capable of storing 4.2% to 65% of their own weight in hydrogen. Nanotube technology will meet the challenge of storing hydrogen and releasing the aromatically in hydrogen fuel carrying tubes. So it may possible that by application of carbon nanotube, we may use hydrogen as a fuel in our car or any other vehicle. Fissures absorption and chemo absorption. These are the two mechanisms which are used. These are absorption techniques which is used in storage of any property of material. So here, by using these two techniques, it is possible to store hydrogen on carbon nanotubes because they are stored in the pore of pores which are present inside the tube. Now, whether it is possible to use it in market or not. So researchers have developed a cost-effective process for large-scale production of carbon nanotube called COMOCAT, but still it is under the process only. Dennis researchers at DTU say tablets are safe and cheap. This is one group of US, this is another group of Dennis which work on the hydrogen storage, and they found that the tablets may be used as a storage device for the hydrogen. No data available on the cost of storage because many methods are in research and development or testing stages. So these are the things which may affect the use of hydrogen fuel even in the future, by next 5 to 10 years. Then there are some government issues also. In case of infrastructure, an obstacle way to hydrogen economy because infrastructure required for hydrogen storage is very high. The second one, existing hydrogen fuel station few and far between, only 73 worldwide. Throughout the world, only 73 hydrogen fuel storage stations are available. Next one is the Energy Act. This is for US. energy and carbon tax incentive for those who purchase energy efficient vehicles. Like fuel cell vehicles, it is costing approximately $12,000 income tax credit, whereas in case of alternative fuel vehicles, hydrogen fuel vessel, that is only $4,000. Some other applications of the nanomaterials or nanotechnology in sports, tennis rackets and balls are used, which are very strong and very having better strength with the lightweight. Other game balls and equipments, toys like eye movement of doll, robot movement in the toys are based on the nanotechnology. Textile, this is again beauty of the nanotechnology by use of synthetic fiber. We just put some of the nanomaterials in the synthetic fiber and they giving the feeling of the cotton material, and even we don't require the every time washing and cleaning or ironing of the synthetic fiber. In market, maybe 6-7 years back also, in market we have the washing machines which contain the silver nanoparticles which makes the clothes germ free and maintain the shining of the clothes. In cosmetics, this is again an important one. Zinc oxide and titanium oxide nanoparticles are used in the creams, face cream and all those. They absorb all the ultraviolet light and protect the skin from damage due to the sunlight. And there some other applications like domestic applications, use of nanoparticles is made into the refrigerator, air purifier, then water purifier and many more applications of the nanotechnology. The next class we will talk about the applications in aerospace, the computer technology and number of other applications. Thank you.